So now let us discuss about the cause of SHM. What is causing the SHM? Can you tell me a basic requirement for the SHM? A basic requirement for any SHM. Okay. A force is required. What kind of force is required? That is what I am asking. See, here what happens is that force is zero here. No doubt about it. But when object is going this way, the force should be in that direction. When object is going this way, the force should be in that direction. Okay, so what happens is, when force becomes zero at the mean position, the velocity doesn't become zero. Acceleration becomes zero. So because velocity is not zero, it continues to move in this direction. And as soon as it starts moving this way, force acts in the opposite direction and it tries to push it towards the mean position. Every time the object goes away from the mean position, a force is there to push it back to the mean position. So the basic requirement for any SHM to happen is restoring force that we have discussed last class. So a restoring force is required for oscillation to happen. What is the restoring force? A restoring force. Restoring force always tries to push towards mean position. Okay, it tries to push it towards a mean position, but unfortunately, what happens is it is like there is an invisible hand which is trying to bring an object closer to the mean position like that by applying force from this way and from that way. I am trying to bring an object at the center. But unfortunately, but even though force is zero at mean position, due to inertia and velocity, object moves away from mean position. Away from mean position. And when it goes away, again another force tries to bring it towards a mean position. Again its velocity goes, makes it go away from the mean position on the other side. So again, force comes it and make it come towards the mean position. So like this, it keeps on happening. So what is required? A restoring force is required. Then this oscillation will happen. A force should be such, always it will make object go towards the mean position, as in accelerate towards the mean position. Okay. So if that is the case, then your force should be proportional to negative times x. When x is positive, your force should be negative. When x is negative, your force should be positive. Force is this way when you are here, force is that way when you are here, which is perfectly in sync with what is acceleration in the SHM. For acceleration, A is equal to minus of omega square x, we know it already, right? So force is equal to minus of m omega square x. Okay, now, can you tell me a scenario in which you can imagine an SHM other than pendulum? Can you imagine a scenario in which simple harmonic motion can exist to and fro? Correct. So a spring block system I will just analyze one of them to you. Did I give any assignment last week? Did I give? Oh, is that the reason why you guys are completely unprepared today? I should have given assignment. Here is a block of mass m. Okay. Now, at present, the spring is in its natural length. Spring constant is k, right? Spring in its natural length. Now, what you do is that you are moving the mass by a distance of x, let's say. By some distance x, you have moved it. And then you have released it. Can you imagine that SHM is started happening? SHM start happening like this. Can you imagine that, all of you? Once you stretch it and leave it, it will do SHM oscillation, it will do. Are you able to imagine it? If you're not able to imagine it, then leave the chapter. You need to understand physics is best done by visualizing it. You need to feel that, yes, there's a spring, there's a block. If I stretch it, leave it, it'll start doing oscillation. Are you able to feel it or not? Okay, Shitej, Auro, Pradyun, others? Okay, great. All right, now, if you have a block over here, we have a block over here, then after you release it, spring is stretched. After you release it, can you tell me what is the acceleration of this block? Once you have stretched it by x and then you are about to release it, what is its acceleration? All of you. Half kx square is its potential energy. Okay. So will the acceleration, forget about acceleration, the force is k times x horizontally, right? Spring is stretched by a distance of x. So acceleration is kx by m. This is the acceleration. Now tell me, is acceleration and x, they are in opposite direction or in the same direction? Everyone. A and x, they are in opposite direction or in the same direction? X is like this. this is x, and A is like that, right? They're in opposite direction. So if you want to write it in vector form, there will be a minus sign over here. Okay. Now clearly you can compare it with SHM equation. A is equal to minus omega square x, right? So when you compare it, you get omega is equal to root over k by m, right? So what is the time period of SHM? Everyone, time period of SHM is what? 2 pi by omega, 2 pi by omega, right? So it will become 2 pi root over m by k. Okay. This is how you do this. All right. So let's take few more spring block system, because spring block system is a very common system which can perform simple harmonic motion. In fact, in your NCERT book, most of the examples are spring block systems only. I forgot to ask, what is happening in the school? Still SHM, waves, waves, waves. So you have two batches in Kormangala. Different classes, okay, fine. Okay, so see, we can take a few questions right now, or I can talk about steps of solving problems, which is common for all the questions, and then we can take multiple questions. Okay, we will solve every question step by step like this. Write down. These steps of problem solving, they are not meant to constrain your thinking. You should not force yourself to do it like this only. These steps will help you to align your thought process properly. That's all. Okay. After maybe doing 5-10 questions, you can forget about these steps of solving problem. So we had done just now, we had done one problem wherein we need to find the time period of a system, time period of oscillation of a system. So the first step is to identify. Identify the object performing SHM, which you do it anyways. But sometimes even that is tricky. Okay, so we'll see that later on. Second is what you need to identify? Identify the path of SHM. Okay. Third, identify what? Can you guess what we need to identify next? Yes, identify the mean position. How you identify it? At the mean position, net force is zero along the path of SHM. Okay. Next. Displace the object by some distance x away from main position along the path of SHM. Okay, so when you displace it and you leave it, your x is amplitude. X is your amplitude. Look at it. Previous question. When you leave the mass from here, it will try to go back. So this point automatically becomes mean position. Sorry, extreme position. All right. So X is amplitude. That is the maximum distance from the mean position, because after you leave it, it starts going towards the mean position. Fifth, identify net unbalanced force along the path. What path? SHM path. Now, you know, there is a trick here, which I should tell you right away here, that the net force at mean position is what? At mean position, net force is zero. Okay. Does it mean that no forces are applied there? Does it mean no forces are there, or total force is zero? What does it mean? Total force is zero. Okay. There might be no having no force and total force zero are two different things. Okay. Total force is zero there. Getting it? Total sum of all the forces. So if sum of all the forces are zero, it doesn't mean that there are no forces. There might be multiple forces. They all add up to zero at the mean position. Okay. So when you displace it, when you displace the object little bit, you need to only focus on those forces which are coming because of the displacement. Because whatever was the force before the displacement, they were all balanced and they were equal to zero. So when you displace it, whatever extra force comes because of displacement, that is the net force. Okay, you will understand what I'm talking about when we take a question after writing all of this. So the force due to displacement is the net force. Due to displacement is net force. Okay. Then once you get the force, acceleration is, write it like this, acceleration is equal to omega square. Achha. The point of caution here is that the net force must be towards mean position. Otherwise, it will not do SHM. Okay. When you displace it this side, the force should appear on the other side. Okay. So then the last step is compare it with this equation, omega square x, and you can then write down time period as 2 pi by omega. Anyone has any doubts in these steps? Now, whatever problem we do going forward, 2-3 questions, we'll be doing every step like this only, all one by one. Anyone has any doubts in these steps of solving problems? Fifth step, what? What is your doubt? Doubt is what? No doubts? Is it clear to everyone? Type in. All right. Step number 5 will be clear when we take examples. I don't want to tell stories without taking an example. So let's take an example. I'll relate to that. Okay. So all of you all set. Here is the next example. Vertical spring is there. Like this, there is a mass M and spring constant K. Earlier case, spring was horizontal. Now the spring is vertical. Same scenario. You need to find the time period here also. Okay, we have already done for the time period of the horizontal spring. Can you do it for this? How much it is? G is vertically down. In the previous case, at the mean position, the spring was in its natural length. Here is the spring at its natural length when it is at the mean position. Path of SHM, very clear, right? Path of SHM is this, vertical, okay? Along this path, you do the SHM, okay? So at the mean position, can you tell me what is the extension in the spring? At the mean position, extension in the spring is how much? Condition for the mean position is what? Net force, which is mg minus kx naught, initial extension kx naught to zero. Upside, the force is kx naught, and down, the force is mg, okay? So extension in the spring, when it is at the mean position, is this, okay? This is extension, all right? Now, when you displace the object, you displace from this location. This is already there, okay? So now you are moving down, let's say, by a distance of x, okay? By distance of x, you have moved down. Can you tell me what is the net force along the path of SHM? Do it yourself. This is probably the simplest of all the questions to come. You need to understand this. Doing yourself is the best. Not getting it? When I'm displacing the object by a further distance of x, further if I displace it by x, total spring force will be how much on it? Total spring force will be how much? Everyone, x naught was anyway there. Further you have extended by x, total spring force will be how much? Kx plus x naught, right? Kx plus x naught above and mg down. So the total force is kx plus x naught minus mg. Okay, this is equal to kx plus kx naught minus mg. What is kx naught minus mg? This is what the bracket term, zero. So the total force is kx. All right, getting it? Now you could have got kx directly. You don't need to do this circle by writing kx plus x naught minus mg. Why? Because earlier all the forces were balanced at the mean position. Whatever extra force comes because of the further displacement from the mean position, that is the total force. So from the mean position, if I displace by x, only k into x force extra will come. So net was anyway zero. Whatever extra comes will be the total force. So that is why it is kx. So this kx should be equal to mass times acceleration. And you can see that the equation looks exactly the same. From here, omega is root over k by n. And time period is 2 pi root m by k. All of you clear about this? Type in, is it clear? This is your school level questions. Useful for your UTs. This kind of question was done in your school or not? Nobody wants to comment. This is theta. You have a block of mass m kept like this. Okay, this surface is smooth. Again, find out the time period of SHM, everyone. Exact same way you have to do, the way we had done the previous question, you will get the answer. What is the initial extension in the spring? Anyone got it? Correct. Path of SHM, is it clear, right? Along the incline it is mg sine theta. This is normal reaction, that is mg cos theta, and initial extension is x naught, so this is, let's say, kx naught. So when mg sine theta and the other forces in the direction of SHM, when they add up to zero, that is when you will reach the mean position. So at the mean position, extension in the spring is this much. Okay, this is the extension. Now what do you do? What is the next step after you get the mean position? What is the next step, everyone? Displace an object, displace that object by a distance of x. Let's say you have displaced this way. You can displace either ways. You could have displaced upward also, doesn't matter. This is x. So can you tell me the net force in the path of SHM? Everyone, net force, total force. After you displace it by a distance of x, what is the net force? Can I directly write net force is kx? Can I directly write it? Before displacement, before you are displacing from the mean position, at the mean position, all the forces were anyway added up to zero. Okay, so whatever extra force that comes due to the displacement, that is a net force. Clear, right? So when you're displacing it by x, some extra force of kx comes in. That is a net force. Are you getting it? All of you, you don't need to write again that kx plus x naught minus mg sine theta. You can write this, then also get kx only. No problem. But why are you lengthening the process? So acceleration is k by m times x in a vector form, negative because they're in opposite directions. So omega is root of k by m. And yes, surprise, that the time period does not depend on how the spring and block are kept. It is always 2 pi under root m by k only. Okay. See, my logic is very simple. The logic is if you write 8 minus 8 is 0, okay, you anyway know 8 minus 8 is 0. So when you add 4 to it, you don't need to do 8 minus 8 again. Whatever extra you are adding is your total. Same thing here, at mean position, anyway net force is adding up to 0. So whatever extra force comes in is your net force. Is it clear now? Okay. Keep it simple. Now tell me, do you remember in work power energy chapter, we had done multiple springs together, spring in series, spring in parallel. You remember that? Don't remember. Okay, so I'm not going to derive it again. Derivation, you can look at your notes. So if springs are connected like this, one spring like this, another spring like that, then this is the parallel connection. So equivalent spring constant is what in this case? This K1, K2. I can say that this is equivalent to a single spring and a block where spring constant K is sum of 1 and 2s. Okay. And if spring is connected like that, then if I tell that it is equivalent to a single spring, then what, how will you find out the equivalent spring constant in this case? Do you remember that? Do you remember that? Correct. Gurman got it. 1 by K is equal to 1 by K1 plus 1 by K2. Okay, this is the parallel connection and this is the series one. Okay. Remember this, this will help you in questions in which multiple springs are there, and yes, that way it will be useful. Now let's take up a few more questions. Mechanics is all about problem solving. Theory doesn't help in any ways. You have to do a lot of questions, then only it will be clear. There is a spring of spring constant K. There is a block here which has mass M. This mass is projected with a velocity of V. Okay. This distance is L. All collisions, collision between wall and mass is elastic. Okay, and mass after hitting massless spring compresses it, starts compressing. So can you describe the movement here? The mass will go, hit the spring, compresses the spring. Then what will happen? Spring will come back. And then what will happen? All of you, the mass goes this way, then it will come back. What will happen to the spring? Will mass leave the spring? Everyone? after this cycle is completed, till the spring is getting compressed, spring is with the mass. Okay, as soon as the spring reaches the natural length, will spring be in contact with the mass or not? No, right? No, it'll leave the spring, and what will happen? The mass will go, hit the wall, again come back, again compresses the spring. So this will keep on happening. All right, you need to tell me time period of oscillation for the mass. Time period of oscillation for mass. Do it. In this zone, when it is not in contact with the spring, can I say that velocity will be constant? Can I say that? When it is moving without any contact with the spring, is the velocity fixed? The kinetic energy gets converted into potential energy of the spring, then again it gains the kinetic energy, velocity reverses, comes back, hits the wall, with whatever velocity it hits the wall, it comes back. So in this zone, velocity always remains V, and the spring, when it hits the spring, it completes half the oscillation every time. Half the oscillation is with the spring, and other half of the oscillation is with the this non-spring thing. So it is covering two L length is covered with a velocity of V, and you have half of time period for spring. So total time period is 2L by V plus, you remember time period for the spring block system is 2 pi root m by k, so half it, because in every oscillation only half of the oscillation for the spring is taking part. So this is how it will be in J advanced. Okay, you should be aware, that's why I told you. All right, so let's take a break now. I think now we can take a break, and after the break we can continue with same thing. We'll continue taking couple of more questions, then I'll talk about the energy related to the simple harmonic motion. Okay, fine. So we'll meet at 6:16 p.m. Let me take up questions directly from here. Not this. This one. There are many these kind of questions which you will see. It's a simple question only. Don't get worried about too much of text. There are multiple parts of the same question. Try doing it. Time period is what? First tell me that. Time period is what? Both the masses are moving together. So time period is? Look at your notes. Just now we discussed spring block system. Okay. Two pi under root. Do you all agree? It will be this 2 pi under root m plus capital M by K. Do you all understand this? How it comes? Type in. So answer it. Okay. Otherwise I'll feel that you are not able to do it. Then I have to do this thing again, right? This is part A. Now, part B. Pradyun, where you went in middle of a class and then rejoined? You, Ansh, and I think Arya also. Where you three went virtually? Okay. All right, do the B part, all of you. How you do the B part? Draw the free body diagram. You'll get the answer easily. Free body diagram of small m. Anyone close to the answer? Or should I have to? Have you drawn the free body diagram, everyone? So what is stopping you to get the answer? Tell me, this is normal reaction. This is a small mg. Will there be an acceleration? Will there be an acceleration? All of you, the displacement from the mean position is x. So is there an acceleration for small m? How much? How much? If x is in this direction, this block is here right now. So how much and in which direction is the acceleration? Tell me direction first, left or right? Acceleration, left. How much? Omega square x. Omega is what? For this system, what is omega? Under root k by m is omega. So k divided by m plus capital M is omega. So that is square x. So kx divided by m plus capital M. This is your acceleration. All of you able to understand this? Type in. Is it clear? Now tell me, friction will be in which direction? Left or right? Friction will be in the left hand side or right hand side? Left or right? Friction on small m. It will be, of course, on the left hand side. On the left hand side. Why? Acceleration is on the left hand side. There has to be a force to create that acceleration. And only force available in the direction of acceleration is friction only. Okay. See, usually what happens is, when you learn rigid body motion, you're like, oh, can I use the laws of motion concept or work by energy chapter? Then similarly, when you learn the simple harmonic motion, you hesitate to use laws of motion concept in simple harmonic motion. You should not. Everything that you have learned till now is science. Science won't change chapter to chapter. You can use it. Okay, equation of motion you cannot use in SHM. Why? Because acceleration is not constant. There's a reason to it. But you can use v is equal to dx by dt and a is equal to dv by dt, which is valid everywhere. Similarly, Newton's second law is valid everywhere, which you can use here also. So there has to be a force to create the acceleration. So that friction should be equal to small m into acceleration, m kx divided by small m plus capital M. This is the force of friction. Now do the C part. It's an easier part to do. You'll get it easily. All of you attempted? What can be the maximum amplitude? If amplitude is maximum, what else will be maximum? What else will be maximum? Everyone, if amplitude is maximum, what else will be maximum? X is maximum, correct. What else? Acceleration is maximum, right? Acceleration is maximum, correct. And because acceleration is maximum, can I say friction has to be maximum? Because acceleration is maximum, because if I have to get maximum acceleration, I need to apply maximum force. Yes or no? And what is the maximum value of friction? What is the maximum value of it? Mu times normal reaction. In this case, normal reaction is mg. I can write it as directly. This should be equal to omega square k divided by m plus capital M into small m into a. Basically, I'm writing mass m acceleration here. Omega square a is acceleration into mass. So maximum amount of force should be equal to this. So from here, amplitude of the oscillation, maximum possible amplitude so that it doesn't slip over, is mu g small m plus capital M divided by ka. Okay, sorry, that's it. Have everyone understood this? Type in, is this clear? Similarly, there are many such questions. Okay, chapter is very small, but because mechanics get mixed into it, there are so many numericals, you know, which you can solve. I'll send you more questions in the assignment. Let us continue and let me do whatever I have to do today. Later on, if whatever time is left, maybe 15-20 minutes, then we can again come back to the problems. Okay, so let's proceed further. We will now talk about angular SHM. All right, write down. What comes in your mind when you hear this term, angular SHM? Circular motion. Circular motion is SHM. Is it SHM? What comes in your mind? Angular SHM. Anything? Nothing. Nothing. That is strange. So pendulum. Pendulum will come in your mind. We are basically studying the pendulum. There are two kinds of pendulum. Simple pendulum and physical pendulum. Okay, so we'll discuss it one by one. First, let us talk about the simple pendulum. Okay, write down simple pendulum. What is a simple pendulum? There is a string which is coming from a fixed point like this, and a mass is attached here as a bob. A small mass like this is attached. Mass M. Okay. We need to find out time period of SHM here. Time period of SHM, but the SHM that is happening here, it is not SHM in a straight line. You need to understand that. The SHM which is happening here, which variable we are taking into account? when it was linear SHM, your variable was X. Here, what is a variable? Here, the variable is theta. Okay, and SHM is following this curved path. All right. Do you understand what I'm talking about here, everyone? So what I'm saying here is that if acceleration, which is equal to d square x by dt square, is equal to minus omega square x. If this gives me simple harmonic equation as x equal to a sine omega t plus phi, then alpha, which is equal to d square theta by dt square, when this is equal to minus omega square theta, will this give me theta equals to any maximum possible angle theta naught into sine of omega t plus phi? Does it make sense? If this will give me this SHM of x, this equation will give me SHM of theta, because mathematics doesn't care whether you write A in terms of alpha or X in terms of theta, you'll get the similar looking solution. Now, is it clear to everyone? This is the angular SHM because theta is doing SHM. Theta is increasing, goes to maximum, comes back, becomes zero, then again maximum on the other side. Simple harmonic motion, which was linear, it was happening on a straight line like this. This one, we are tracking angle. Angle increases, decreases, then again increases on the other side. So that is how it is. Is it clear to everyone? Type it quick. Tell me what is your doubt, if not clear. Okay, you want me to take your names? All right. Arya, what are you doing? There's no doubt from you. It has been more than 2.5 hours now. Focus is somewhere else. I am asking, is it clear how much time and effort it takes for you to reply, everyone? Gurman, what's going on? Everything is fine, Gurman? You appears to be, at the start, you were very proactive. You were answering questions. Now something has happened. Okay. Is it clear to everyone? Now I think only 2 or 3 people are left. They want me to take their names so that they can make huge amount of effort to type that yes, it is clear. Okay. So if I get an equation like this, alpha in terms of theta, if I get alpha as minus omega square theta, even this will give me SHM for theta. Okay, this was giving me SHM for X. All right. So let us try to see if we can convert this simple pendulum thing equation like that. All right. Then we can get the time period of pendulum also. Okay. So let's say you have a pendulum like that. Like this, there is a pendulum, mass M and length L. Okay, you need to find time period. Now, you remember when was SHM on a straight line, what you do to find time period? You displace by small distance x. Here, what you have to do? Any guesses? If you have to find out the time period, here what you have to do? Displace by small angle theta. Okay? Here you have to do that way. Displace by small angle theta. And then in the case of linear SHM, we got acceleration. Once you got force, from force you got acceleration. Here you need to get angular acceleration. Okay, angular acceleration you have to get equation like this. So how you get the angular acceleration in the expression? From where this comes? This comes from Newton's second law, force equal to mass m acceleration. How alpha will come in the equation? How alpha will come? Any guesses? In the school, have you done simple pendulum also without taking alpha only? Without taking alpha, you calculated the time period in the school? No alpha? Oh, so they have taken mg sin theta and taken components and all that. Okay. But anyways, we'll first do with the alpha. Can you tell me one equation in which alpha comes? Just like force equal to mass m acceleration, there is an equation in which alpha comes. Do you remember torque is equal to I alpha about the fixed axis? Torque equation, right? So there is this object is experiencing torque about this axis, about that axis. Okay. So after displacing it by theta, can you tell me what is the torque about this axis, fixed axis? What is the torque? Tell me. In the free body diagram, there will be tension, there will be mg. What is the torque due to the tension, everyone? Torque due to tension is how much? Type in. Tension torque is zero because tension force passes through the axis. All right. What is the torque due to mg? Torque due to mg is what? MgL. No, this is the force. What is its perpendicular distance from the axis? This line of force, perpendicular distance. It will take this distance, right? Perpendicular distance. MgL sine theta. Okay. MgL sine theta. Do you all agree? This is the net torque. MgL sine theta. This should be equal to I alpha. What is I? Moment of inertia about this axis, how much? This is not a rod, just a point mass. How much? ML square, right? ML square it is. So you can get I is ML square into alpha is MGL sine theta. Okay. M is gone. One of the L is gone. Alpha is equal to G by L. Now theta is very small. So sine theta is roughly theta. Okay. Theta is small. In a vector form, alpha and theta, they are in opposite direction. So when you compare it with this equation, you will get omega to be equal to root over G by L. So time period is how much? 2 pi root L by G. See why I have done like this? Because there are many different kinds of pendulum that the force method which you have done in the school is not useful to those cases. So you must know that using torque equation also, if you get alpha as minus constant times theta, that constant is omega square. Why isn't it sine theta? Because theta is very small. It will do SHM only when theta is small. Okay. If theta is large, it won't do simple harmonic motion. Theta is small, so sine theta is roughly theta in radians. I hope this is clear. Why negative sign came? Negative sign came because theta is what? Anti-clockwise, and torque is clockwise. Torque is trying to rotate this way. So if you want to write in vector form, alpha is in opposite direction of theta. Clear? Aro? Any other doubt? See, this is what I want. You ask a lot of doubts. All right. So now let us do the way you have done in school also, because school exams are also very important. So let us say this is the pendulum. You have displaced by small angle theta. This is theta. Okay. Theta is very small. So this is mg. The acceleration at the start, acceleration will be perpendicular to the string or not? Everyone, can there be acceleration will be in this direction only or not? Along the string, acceleration is zero. Along the string, acceleration is zero. So because string is of fixed length, it can't move. That is different. If omega comes in, there will be centripetal acceleration. But right now, omega is zero. We are just releasing it. So if this is theta, then this angle is theta. So the perpendicular to the string, the net force is mg sine theta. This is the net force. Net force is equal to mass times acceleration. All right. So acceleration is equal to g sine theta. Now theta is very small. So I can say that, you know, we are assuming when we do like this, we are assuming that the bob is moving in a straight line. And if this is x, sine theta is equal to x by L. Because theta is very small, sine theta, you can write like this. And you can assume that bob has moved along this straight line. And then, of course, A and X are in opposite directions of this. So when you compare it with this equation, you will get omega to be root of G by L. Okay. So time period is 2 pi root L by G. Okay. Why can't we use it for other cases? Because other cases, rigid bodies are involved. And in rigid bodies, the best way to analyze it by using torque equation. You have seen it in a rigid body, right? So this is the way it is done in your school. So if it is an school exam, I request you to do this. This is for school. All right, don't use the torque equation for the school thing. Now, I will tell you the physical pendulum, what it is. Something very important. So this is, let's say, a rod. A rod is this, and there is a hole here. Sorry, there is a hinge here, and this rod can swing like that. So in physical pendulum, basically, simply I can say that in the case of physical pendulum, rigid body is oscillating. Rigid body oscillates. It's like if I take a rigid body like this, some random rigid body I can take, and if I move it like this, it starts oscillating. Okay, this is definitely not, it is, let's say it is oscillating like that. Okay, this is definitely not a simple pendulum. So like this, I can take any object, displace it a little bit, and then it will do the SHM. Okay, I better example would be bottle. I can put a hinge over here, displace it like that, and it will start oscillating like that. Okay, this is not a simple pendulum. Okay, so here is an example for you. There's a rod of mass M and length L. A uniform rod of mass M and length L. You need to find out the time period of oscillation for this. It is hinged at one of its ends over here. Do the way we have done the torque method. You'll get the answer. It's very simple. Make some effort from your side. It is required. Trust me. You can't just look at the screen and copy it. You'll forget in some time then. The normal forces on hinge, yes, there are hinge forces, but what is the torque due to the hinge forces? How much is the torque about that axis, hinge axis? It is zero. Okay, so that is why it is better to use the torque method. That is another reason. Thank you. Okay, Pradyun, it should be in terms of theta. Alpha should be in terms of theta. You've taken theta equal to something, is it? Theta is very small. Okay, Anusha got something. Others? Okay, should I attempt it? Okay, good to see that many of you have attempted. Fine, should I do it now? The rod need to get displaced by some angle theta like this. If you don't need to draw the hinge forces, but then why you need to don't need to do it? Because the hinge forces torque is zero about that. There'll be mg from center of mass. Okay. So mg is this. Any other force? No other force, right? This is mg. So what is the torque due to mg, everyone? Torque due to mg about the fixed axis. How much it is? This distance from here to here, that distance is L by 2. This is L by 2. So its perpendicular distance is this. This yellow line, let me draw a red line. This horizontal red line is the perpendicular distance, right? So that perpendicular distance is L by 2 sine theta. So torque is mg L by 2 sine theta. This is the torque. Moment of inertia, what you will take? M L square by, what is the moment of inertia about this axis? ML square by 3, that into alpha. So M goes away, alpha will be equal to 3G by 2L times theta. Theta is very small, sine theta become theta. In a vector form, theta is anti-clockwise, alpha is clockwise. So that is a minus sign in a vector form. So when you compare it with SHM equation, you will get omega to be root over 3g by 2l. How do you know it's very small? It is my choice. This is valid only for very small angle theta. Okay. Is it clear to everyone? This is a physical pendulum. Okay. Fine. So let's take up this. Let's get the time period of oscillation for any random rigid body. Okay, let's say this is a rigid body, which you are, what is this? You can just create a random object like this. You are hanging from here. Can you tell me, can you tell me anything about where the center of mass of this rigid body should be? The rigid body is, rigid body can rotate about this axis. Can you tell me anything about the center of mass location related to that? Anything? Right now it is at rest. The question is, Aro, the question is, can you tell me anything with respect to center of mass location? Like you can tell me that it should be right hand side, it should be left hand side, it should be horizontal, it should be vertical, where it should be. Anything related to the location, can you say? It has to be correct. Can it be anywhere other than this vertical line? Is it possible to have center of mass other than this straight line passing through the hinge vertical? Center of mass, can it be here, this side? Can it be there? If it is there, then what will happen? There's a torque, it will rotate, and it will not stop till center of mass is along this line. So if center of mass is along this line, then the net torque due to gravity also becomes zero, because the gravity force is vertical, right? So the hinge force's torque is also zero, and the gravity force torque is also zero. So this is in equilibrium right now. Okay. Now, if I tell you that this distance, is D, okay, and moment of inertia about the fixed axis is I. Can you get the time period for this, all of you? Time period of oscillation. Same way you have to do. Everything is repetitive. Yes, torque about fixed axis is zero. You have to, what is the process of finding time period? You have to displace it by some angle theta and then look at the net torque, and that you equate to I alpha. Okay, Shitij Simha got something. Others? One second. Okay, given one second. When you rotate the rigid body by a small angle theta, your center of mass reaches here. Okay. So this is mg. What is the torque due to gravity, everyone? This is d. Torque due to gravity is what? When I'm not redrawing the rigid body when it has rotated, because it's a random shape, I'm just drawing a green line. Green line represents what happens to that red line after you rotate it. Entire rigid body will get rotated. MGD sine theta, right? MGD sine theta. This should be equal to I alpha. Okay. So alpha is equal to MGD by I times sine theta. Theta is very small. Sine theta is theta. So alpha and theta are in opposite direction. So minus, and you can compare it with equation of the angular SHM. So omega will be equal to root over. Now you guys can see that the things are getting repetitive now. Once you do enough questions, it'll become repetitive for you, and you start looking at every question as if it is similar to each other. Okay, so this is the physical pendulum for all of you. You will get some questions on this in the assignment. Please try that. It is very important that you go slightly beyond NCRT. If you restrict yourself with NCRT, there are many students who do that. You are among them. So if you want to improve your ranks in any exam which you are aiming at, you have to go beyond it. Not too much, but at least you should be aware of these things. Okay, so we will now talk about the energy consideration. Energy in SHM. So for a spring block system, let's take an example of spring block system. At any moment, let's say this is a scenario. Right? This is the scenario. This is the mass. At any moment, let's say, all of you agree that at the mean position, the spring will be in its natural length, right? Because it is horizontal right now. So if we start the oscillation in this case, okay, then the total energy will be equal to sum of potential energy plus kinetic energy, right? There is no other energy, and friction is zero. It is smooth. So is there any way sum of potential energy plus kinetic energy can decrease? Is there any way that will decrease, or potential energy plus kinetic energy will always remain constant? There is no external work done. There is no external work done. So you know that work energy theorem. This is equal to final kinetic energy plus potential energy minus initial kinetic energy plus potential energy. So if work done is zero, the sum of kinetic energy plus potential energy won't change. This minus that is zero. So final will be equal to initial. So mechanical energy will be conserved. Okay. So let's see how much is the mechanical energy in the case of simple harmonic motion. Okay. So kinetic energy in this case can be simply written as half m v square. What I can write potential energy as, everyone? U is what? What is U? Correct. Half kx square. Half kx square is U. Now, is there any relation between V and X? Because it is SHM, yes, there is a relation wherein v is equal to omega under root a square minus x square. So can you prove that kinetic energy plus potential energy is a constant? All of you, try doing it. Try doing it and tell me how the sum of them is a constant. It should not depend on x. Let me know once you're done. Anyone? Done? Okay. Others? Nobody else? No one else? Okay. C. Energy is equal to half mv square. So v square will become omega square a square minus x square. Plus kinetic energy is half kx square. Can you tell me what is omega in the case of spring block system like this? We have done it previously. Tell me what is omega. Look at your notes. Omega is how much? Root over K by M. K by M, right? So when you put omega as root over K by M over here, you will get half M omega square is K by M. A square minus X square plus half kx square. So you can see that the total energy comes out to be half k into amplitude square. And this doesn't depend upon x. Clear to everyone? Right? So in a spring block system, I can write down potential energy as half kx square and kinetic energy as half k a. Okay, this k and that k look similar. Okay, here there is no confusion. Here I'll write KE so that the spring constant and kinetic energy symbol should not remain same. Kinetic energy is half K A square minus X square. Okay. So you can get the kinetic energy as a function of X here. You don't need to write half MV square. So graphically, how does it look like? If you have to plot the kinetic energy and potential energy for this system, how does it look like? Let us see that. All of you draw this. Box. This length on the y-axis, you have energy. Okay. this length from here to here, this is half k a square. Okay, that center line, this is x equal to 0. Over here, this is x equal to 0. This is x equal to a amplitude, and this is x equal to minus a. All right. Now, I want you to plot the potential energy here, all of you. Plot the potential energy when the particle is at a, 0, and minus a. Entire plot you have to do, all of you. Will it be 0 anywhere? If yes, where? All of you, will it be 0 anywhere? If yes, where? At mean position, see, at the good thing is that in this system, at mean position, the compression or extension, the spring is 0. So potential energy is 0 at the mean position over here. Okay, and where it is maximum? Potential energy is maximum where? At extreme. So can you plot it? Can you plot? It will be a parabola, y is equal to half kx square kind of curve, like this. Are you getting it like that? This is the potential energy, okay? This is the potential energy U. Now, can you plot the kinetic energy? Use some other color, maybe red color. Find out the kinetic energy. What is the kinetic energy at extreme points? Kinetic energy at extreme points. See, potential energy is 0 at the mean position, right? When you say potential energy is 0 at the mean position, is it true for all the SHM or only in this case where spring extension is 0 at the mean position? Potential energy is 0 only in this case because luckily extension in the spring is 0 at the mean position. Okay. But when you talk about kinetic energy, at extreme position, kinetic energy will be 0 for all SHMs, okay? For all SHMs. Yes, Ansh, that potential energy is gravitational potential energy. When you talk about potential, when you talk about pendulum, potential energy is gravitational. Here, when we talk about the spring block, potential energy is spring potential energy. Okay, same kind of thing will be there also. I'll tell you after this. All of you, done with the kinetic energy curve? Will it be downward opening? Are you getting like this? This curve is the kinetic energy. Getting it? Right? Now, can you prove graphically that sum of kinetic energy and potential energy is a constant? Both the curves are symmetrical. It is like you have inverted the yellow curve and made it red. It got rotated by 180 degree and it became red color. So graphically, without any equations, can you just look at the graph and say that kinetic energy plus potential energy is a constant? At any location, over here, let's say, this is what? From here to there, this is the kinetic energy. Okay? And let me use white color. From here to there, that is the potential energy. So you have to prove that wherever you go, the white line plus blue line is a constant. Can you do that? All of you? I can go, let's say, here. This plus this is same. It is same as this blue, this white, when you add it up, should be equal to this blue and this white. Can you prove it? Using graphs. No? No, you don't need to do any construction as such. It's okay. All of you listen here now. This length, when you add blue and white, this length is counted twice or not? All of you. That length is counted twice from here to here. This length is counted twice. Okay. So what you do? You take one of those you take and fix it here. So it becomes total length from here to there. Take this blue line from bottom. Take that blue line from the bottom. It will exactly fit here. Isn't it? Similarly, take this blue line from here. It will exactly fit there because of symmetry. Are you getting what I'm trying to say? Every time when you add kinetic energy and potential energy, it will become half Ka square graphically also. How can you do that? How can you do that? Okay. I am trying to prove here the fact that this length plus this length is equal to this total length. Forget the fact that the length represents energy. You have two lengths. I'm saying these two lengths, when you add, it will become half Ka square wherever you go. That is what I'm trying to say. So when you add these two lengths, you're counting the common distance twice. So take part of it and fix it on top of each other like that. So it becomes half Ka square. Okay, so that is what we have done. You take the blue part and put it over here. Total energy will be constant. Here also take the blue part, put it above. All of you understood? Type in. Is it clear? Okay, so this way you can prove graphically also that kinetic energy plus potential energy is a constant. Okay, now somebody asks about the pendulum, how to do the similar thing. Okay, so let us see that for angular SHMs. In fact, let me draw the full-fledged this thing. This is not given in any book as such, but then since you asked, one of you asked, this is the simple, this is linear SHM. Linear simple harmonic motion. This is the angular SHM. Okay. A direct in and out comparison. I'll draw a few lines like that. So linear SHM is A is equal to minus omega square x. Angular SHM is alpha equals to minus omega square theta. Here you have to use force equation. Here you have to use torque equation. Solution for this equation is x is equal to A sine kx minus, sorry, that's a wave, not oscillation. A sine omega t plus phi. Solution for that is theta equals to theta naught. Theta naught is maximum angle, omega t plus phi. Okay. So if you differentiate, you get velocity is equal to A omega cos of omega t plus phi. Now tell me, when you differentiate theta, what you get? D theta by dt is what? Is it this omega? Is it that omega only? Is d theta by dt, is this omega only? No. What is omega? What is the name for omega? Omega is what? No. In this case, omega is angular frequency. Don't call it angular velocity. Angular frequency is the word. All right? Don't call it angular velocity. But when you differentiate theta, you get angular velocity. All right. But unfortunately, you can't write d theta by dt as omega. Omega is angular frequency of the SHM. Theta dot is d theta by dt. In fact, I should write d theta by dt. Is theta not omega? Cos of omega t plus phi. Now, we also know that V is equal to omega under root of A square minus X square. V is the linear velocity. Similarly here, angular velocity d theta by dt can be written as omega under root of theta naught square, which is angular amplitude minus theta square at whatever theta. You can find out the angular velocity like this. Okay. Now, what other equation? You get acceleration as minus of A omega square sine of omega t plus phi. And here angular acceleration, you can use alpha now. Okay. Because alpha is not here. That is not confusing. Alpha is equal to minus of theta naught omega square sine of omega t plus phi. All right, is it clear to everyone this comparison? So there can be questions on kinematics of the angular SHM. You remember we have taken some numericals on the linear SHM kinematics. Exactly same kind of questions on angular SHM. Instead of x, we'll talk about theta now. But equations are exactly same. All right. So now I think this should clear it. Okay. Shall we do one question? We have, I think, yes. You might not remember, we had done a question sometime back, which you guys took a lot of time and you guys felt that it is an advanced level question. I am going to show you the same question can be done in just two steps by using simple harmonic motion concepts. So suppose this is small m and on top of it. Are you able to recognize this scenario? Capital M. No? This is spring constant K, right? You need to find out minimum distance capital M to be compressed so that small m jumps off the ground. Try doing it by using SHM principles. Of course, it will not be straightforward, but that is how some questions are, right? You need to understand the difficult ones to gain over above others. Can small m jump off while spring is compressed? Can it jump off while spring is in compression? No, clearly no. What is the condition for small m to jump off? What is the condition? Normalization becomes zero. All of you, I think, are smart enough to understand that. And this, when spring is extended, this kx and mg, let's say normal reaction towards, when normal reaction becomes zero, when n plus kx minus mg, this is equal to zero, when it is about to jump off, normal reaction becomes zero and x should be equal to mg by k. Small mg by k. Do you all understand whatever I'm doing here? I'm telling you that this much extension in the spring should be there for this small m to jump off the ground. Is it clear to everyone? Right? Now, right now, spring is compressed. compressed by how much? How much spring is compressed right now from its natural length? All of you answer it. Can you see it is mg by k? The upper block gravity force is balanced by this spring. Mg is down and initial compression is x naught, kx naught above. Okay, this is the scenario right now. Now this is the mean position where spring is compressed. Okay, spring is compressed in the mean position right now. You need to make sure when the block goes to the other extreme, when what will happen is that when you further compress it down, let's say you reach here, after compressing it you reach here, this much is the compression. You have compressed it by a distance of, let's say, d. So will it go above also d from the mean position while doing puff SHM? Right? So from the compress, see, I'm writing this much because I'm explaining. We can do it in just one step. From the compressed state of mg by k, it should go to extended state of small mg by k for this small m to jump off. Okay, getting it? So how much is d? D is how much? When it goes to this position, when you go to this position, the extension, the spring should be this. So what is the value of d? Anyone? Think over it. Now is nothing left actually. How much should be the d? Will d be equal to, see, suppose I have d equals to this, I only compress the spring by this much. So when it goes to the upper extreme, how much is the extension in the spring? Tell me. Suppose this is d, it goes to the upper extreme. The amplitude of the oscillation is however much I am compressing it. So when you go to the upper extreme, what is the compression in the spring? Compression or extension is how much? From the mean position, you have compressed it by this much. So from the mean position, it will go above by mg by k. It was already compressed by mg by k. So it will go back to the natural length at the end. Are you getting it? At this position, other extreme, the spring will become natural length, but I don't want that to happen. I want it to get extended. So d should be equal to m g by k. This will ensure that I reach to the natural length at the other extreme plus small mg by k. So my amplitude should be this much, which will ensure that the spring is in extended state at the top extreme. When it is at the bottom extreme, when it is here at point number one, the spring is compressed by mg by k was anyway there plus whatever is your compression. This much is the compression in the spring initially when you are pushing it down. then same amount, it will go up from the mean position, because amplitude from the mean position is the same distance, the extremes. All right, so this is the answer. Fine, so that's it from my side. Next week, we will continue this chapter. Next week, I have to cover something related to the how you can correlate the circular motion with the simple harmonic motion. Once you understand that, simple harmonic motion analysis becomes even more simpler. And then we will talk about the non-ideal scenarios wherein forced oscillation is there, damping effect is there, resonance is there, and it is the most ignored part of the chapter. Okay, so that is why I have kept entire class just to discuss that, so that you can understand the importance of it. All right, so that's it from my side. I'll send you assignment. Make sure you complete it, because it requires a lot of practice to become comfortable with these topics. Okay, so make sure you do that and submit the assignment in time. Bye.